Hello friends, in this video we shall learn about acute suppurative otitis media. Acute suppurative otitis media is defined as the acute inflammation of the middle ear cleft by pyogenic organisms. The eustachian tube, tympanic cavity, attic, antrum and mastoid air cells constitutes the middle ear cleft. The infection can reach the middle ear through various routes. Most commonly it is via the eustachian tube. It can also spread from the external ear and rarely it can be blood-borne. The predisposing factors include recurrent attacks of common cold and upper respiratory tract infections, exanthemous fevers like measles, diphtheria and whooping cough, infections of tonsils and adenoids, and chronic rhinitis or sinusitis. The most common organism to cause the infection is Streptococcus pneumoniae. Some others include Haemophilus influenza and Moraxella catarrhalis. Acute suppurative otitis media runs through the following stages: the stage of tubal occlusion, stage of pre-suppuration, stage of suppuration, stage of resolution, and the stage of complication. The disease usually starts with the infection of the pharynx, which may lead to edema and hyperemia of the eustachian tube. These figures show the diagrammatic representation of the eustachian tubes in an adult and an infant. The eustachian tube of an adult angles downwards, whereas that in a child is almost straight and wider and shorter than seen in adults. Hence, the infection spreads faster in children than in adults. In adults, forceful blowing of nose while having sinusitis or pharyngitis can lead to the spread of the infection. The spread of infection into the eustachian tube causes edema and blockage of the nasopharyngeal end of the eustachian tube. This is a simplified diagram of the human ear showing the pinna of the ear, the external auditory canal, the tympanic membrane, the middle ear cavity, and the eustachian tube. The explanation of the pathogenesis of this disease can be studied with the help of this diagram. The tubal blockage produced by the edema at the nasopharyngeal end of the eustachian tube causes the remaining air in the middle ear cavity to be absorbed. This produces a negative intratympanic pressure, which will cause the retraction of the tympanic membrane. All these events are included in the stage of tubal occlusion. If there is prolonged tubal occlusion, the tympanic cavity may be then invaded by pyogenic organisms, which will cause hyperemia of the mucosal lining of the middle ear cavity. Inflammatory exudates start appearing in the middle ear cavity and the tympanic membrane may appear congested. This is called the stage of pre-suppuration. Marked pus formation in the middle ear will be observed and the tympanic membrane starts bulging to the point of rupture. This is the stage of suppuration. The tympanic membrane finally ruptures, releasing the pus into the external auditory canal. The symptoms subside and the inflammation starts to resolve in the stage of resolution. In case of highly virulent organisms or in immunocompromised patients, resolution may not occur and the disease spreads beyond the middle ear cavity. And this may lead to mastoiditis, labyrinthitis, petrositis, extradural abscess, meningitis, brain abscess, or lateral sinus thrombophlebitis. This stage, if happens, is called the stage of complication. In the stage of tubal occlusion, the patient may present with deafness and earache, which may not be that much prominent. The lateral process of malleus appears prominent with distorted or no cone of light. The tuning fork tests reveal conductive hearing loss and retraction of tympanic membrane may be observed. If the patient proceeds to the pre-suppurative stage, the earache becomes more marked. Deafness with tinnitus may be observed. In case of children, high degree fever may be seen. Pars tensa will be congested and the tympanic membrane appears red with a cartwheel-like appearance. Tuning fork test reveals conductive hearing loss. In the suppurative stage, there will be excruciating earache. The deafness increases and children may have high degree fever with vomiting and convulsions. The tympanic membrane appears red and bulging with loss of landmarks. A yellow spot may be seen. An X-ray of mastoid shows clouding of air cells due to exudate. The disease results on the rupture of tympanic membrane and evacuation of pus. The earache is relieved and the fever comes down. Blood-tinged discharge may be seen in the external auditory canal, which later becomes mucopurulent. A small perforation may be seen on the tympanic membrane. A diagnosis of acute suppurative otitis media is done mainly through history and clinical examination. The patients are most commonly children who had history of recent throat infection. Otoscopic examination may reveal a bulging red tympanic membrane with cartwheel appearance. Conductive hearing loss is observed in the audiogram. Culture and sensitivity and radiographic tests like CT and MRI are usually not done as a diagnosis can be made clinically. The management includes antimicrobials, decongestant nasal drops, oral nasal decongestant, analgesics and antipyretics, ear toilet, dry local heat, and myringotomy. The antibacterial therapy should be given for a period of at least 10 days. The usual drugs include ampicillin 50 mg per kg per day in 4 divided doses, amoxicillin 40 mg per kg per day in 3 divided doses, and if allergic to penicillin, cefaclor, cotrimoxazole or erythromycin may be given. The decongestant nasal drops include ephedrine, oxymetazolin and silometazolin, 1% in adults and 0.5% in children to relieve the eustachian tube edema and promote ventilation of the middle ear. Oral nasal decongestants like pseudoephedrine 80 mg BD may be given. Analgesic and antipyretics for pain and fever should be given. Ear toilet using a dry mop with a sterile cotton is done and a wick coated with antibiotic may be introduced to remove the discharge. Application of dry local heat may relieve the pain. Myringotomy is done in cases where impending rupture of tympanic membrane, that is, risk of rupture of tympanic membrane is feared. A curvilinear incision is made on the posteroinferior aspect of the tympanic membrane as it is more accessible and there is less chance of damage to the structures behind it. Myringotomy is indicated when there is severe bulging of the tympanic membrane with severe pain, antibiotic therapy is not effective, and if there is persistent effusion beyond 12 weeks.